So today we're hoping to find out from this Egyptian head from Canterbury Museum. We're going to find out from my point of view, a forensic investigation of the head, to find out perhaps the age of the individual, the sex of the individual, plus maybe any aspects related to the mummification process of the ancient Egyptians.
I'm an archaeological conservator, and I've brought along an Egyptian head, and it's sadly a head that's divorced from its body, divorced from its context. We don't really know much about it at all, and it belongs to Canterbury Museums and Galleries. So it was in bad shape. It needed repackaging, and it needed some restructuring on the cheek. So my role as a conservator has been to do that work and get it all stabilized, but also to investigate and try to find out as much as we can about the head.
Well, I know from previous experience of Egyptian mummification that they replace the eyes with either metalwork or precious stones. So it'd be interesting to see whether they have that in this instance. There could be other things as well. Perhaps there'll be evidence of resin within the brain, the skull cavity. They use that to preserve the body. So you could see that at the bottom.
It could have come in the 19th century or the early 20th century. I think there was a lot of people traveling to Egypt and bringing things back, and actually trading of mummy parts has gone on even back to the Roman period. But we probably think it's early 20th century. It was brought back to England, and it ended up in the hands of a doctor, apparently. So maybe it was sort of a teaching thing, I'm not sure, or a personal collection. But this doctor lived in Canterbury, ultimately, I'm pretty sure. And after he passed away, the head was found in his house in the attic, I think, by relatives, is what the story was. So they didn't know what to do with it, so they donated it to Canterbury. His head to the Canterbury Museums and Galleries.
Previously, there have been lots of investigations of Egyptian mummies in the past. Myself and my colleague Paul Lockwood, we have investigated the Maidstone mummy called Tarkush, and that was that had a CT scan at a local hospital in Maidstone, and we investigated the head and face for that one as well, learning about the age and the dental state of that individual, and also the evidence of replacements of the pupils of the eye with stonework.
I'm just looking forward to coming to a place working with James, who's used to doing medical radiology, and the expertise that he's going to bring to the project, I think, is tremendous. Because I have done, usually with metals, I go to an industrial facility, and but to have this expertise of James put on, and so I'm looking forward to hearing what we discover. Yeah.
Today we'll be using an X-ray machine. It's a medical X-ray machine used within clinical practice, and we'll be taking multiple X-rays. Some of them standard, as you would do within the clinical practice setting. But we'll be taking some interesting different views to try to find out more information about not only the pathologies of the head, but also maybe the packing material, if there is any, and the preservation status of that head. The X-ray session was a success. We gained lots of different views of the head. We discovered that the supports, the white supports that were holding the head in place, didn't really show an X-ray very much. In keeping with their light, their low density nature, they show up a tiny bit, but not enough to really affect the diagnostic value of the X-rays. We've got a variety of views. We've got one from the side, which is called a lateral X-ray, and then we have one from the front, which is an AP X-ray. We have got a variety of other ones, like some obliques to show the teeth from each side, but we kept the head in a supine position, sort of nose upwards, and then turned it around and adjusted our technique accordingly. The limitations that we experienced from it were that we didn't really want to move the head out of its supports, not because we could do that if we wanted to. We could take it out and position into more standardized clinical radiographic technique positions if we wanted to. But as on the horizon, perhaps we want to get a CT scan of the head, I think we'll keep it, what we thought at the time, we keep it in the support, get what we wanted to do to get a visualization of the dental status, etc. and then plan ahead to get that CT scan to show the underlying structures. Other limitations, the machine actually wasn't a limitation. The machine as a clinical machine, able to take x-rays of people's skulls very easily, it was not a problem. We had to experiment a little bit with the exposure values, but otherwise it was a overround success. This is the lateral view of the skull. And on that, we can see a lot of different anatomy of this this mummy's head. A couple of things spring out to me. The front part of the skull, where the glabella is, the frontal part, portion of the skull, is very, very, it's not very pronounced. It doesn't stick out very far, which gives the indication that perhaps this is a female. Again, around the back of the head there, it's not, the base of the skull is not very protruding. Again, a grey style feature, sort of in keeping with a female. There are a couple of other features that give an indication of a female in this instance. We look at the AP of the skull, change the brightness there. The mandible is very, very slight. It's not very pronounced, not very rugged. Again, a sort of a grey style female characteristics. Aspects that we can see from both of the x-rays, excellent definition of the bone. Very, very good demonstration of the different structures. The teeth, I suppose, are a difficulty because they're overlapping. The jaw is shut apart from the tongue sticking out, which we can see. But otherwise, with the help of the oblique skull x-rays, we can just about see the teeth and their profile. With the lateral skull x-ray, we can see just a little bit of artifact from the supports. So just around this area here, we can see it, just a couple of little white blobs, which is actually the side supports being shown in profile. And we can see a little bit of wispiness around the edges, light grey areas, which were the supports as well. We've got a mark on the side to say which side is closest towards the film. And otherwise, it's very well demonstrated. We can see the soft tissue. We can see the structures that are holding the skull together, although they're very obviously desiccated, being mummified. This is one of our oblique x-rays of the skull. It's very difficult to see the dentition with great clarity because the jaw is closed and all the anatomy is overlapping. But by turning the tube and turning the skull in a certain fashion, we can get the mandible from the side and from oblique to try to separate the teeth away from each other. And on here we can see with the mummy's head, the right side closest to the detector, we've separated the lower jaw from the maxilla, and we can see the right hand side of that mandible, and we can see the molars there, which are incredibly worn down. This may be due to the diets that this individual would have had when they were alive. A lot of the grain that they ground down to make bread or flour would have had particles of stone within it, so sand, etc., and that would have increased the wear upon the teeth. So within these x-rays of the oblique mandibles, we can see very clearly a very large amount of wear upon these molars, giving an indication at least of a diet rich in particles that might grind down or wear down the teeth. The extent of the teeth also demonstrates perhaps the age, because they have all of their molars, so we're not looking at a child. One of the questions we had was about the eyes, whether there might be something in the eyes, an artifact, whether it's a precious stone or maybe perhaps even metalwork, which would replace the pupils of the eyes, as seen in some previous examples, published examples of Egyptian mummified heads. In this instance, we can't see anything of high density around the eyes, although the structures of the eyes appear to be there, but I'm not entirely convinced, with the eyes being mostly filled up with the water, with fluid, and being dried out. There wouldn't be anything there, in my opinion. But we do have some sort of light density within the eye region. Now, if we think about the Tarkush mummy, the one that my colleague Paul Lockwood and I wrote about and published, the eyes there were seen, but they were replaced by a material, so packing material. In that case, they did have some sort of high density structure placed on the pupils. But on these x-rays, we can't see anything really. We have a slight density, which is lower density than bone, but higher density than the surrounding air, to suggest there is something in the eyes, which we can see on the photographs as well, but we're not too sure what it is. The structure of it, the composition perhaps, might be inferred again from that CT scan if we manage to get that arranged. The future for this project, I'd say, is hopefully to get that CT scan of the head. And as with Tarkush and the Maidstone Museums, they managed to get a facial reconstruction of their individual. That's based upon the CT data gained. So perhaps we might see the face of this individual, and we might have a greater opportunity to reconstruct the biological profile.